Okay. All right. So let's get started. So yesterday we talked about essentially the fundamental components that are required to make evolution work. Okay. And so the get some chalk. All right. So the idea is that you have some genotype for each organism. Okay, and you can generate variations in the phenotype as a result of mutation. Okay, so now the reason why the genotype is important is it's the genotype of the organism that then determines what its phenotype is going to be. So as a result of the variation in the genotype as a result of the mutations, you're also going to get phenotypic variation. Okay, and then the phenotypic variation, the phenotype is the way that the organism interacts with its environment. Okay, so the phenotype of the organism determines how it's going to interact with the specific environment that the cells are in. Okay, and as a result of this interaction with the environment, some cells are going to do well. That is, they're going to get amplified in the population. Okay, you can also have some mutations that essentially do nothing. Okay, so essentially what would happen would be that the mutation doesn't affect the frequency with which that particular individual shows up in the population. So that would be a neutral kind of thing. Okay, and then you can also have mutations which are bad for the individual. So those are deleterious. Okay, and as a result of how the organism interacts with its environment, that therefore is going to affect how it's able to proliferate in the environment and then therefore affect and evolve the demographics of the population as a result. So now, the kind of mutations that lead to benefits in the environment and therefore amplification, these are what are called positive mutations. These are, reasonably enough, called neutral mutations. And these are negative mutations. Okay, so that's the general idea. So now, how evolution happens and the rates at which evolution happens, you can imagine, depends quite a bit upon what the rates of these kinds of mutations are, and therefore how that then sets how the population is going to evolve over time. So you can imagine asking the kind of question like, what are the rates at which these mutations occur? And then if an organism has a mutation, what's the probability that it's going to be a positive mutation? What's the probability it would be neutral or negative? And it turns out that measuring even the rates is extremely difficult. Okay, and generally it's not done directly. As Matt mentioned, it's inferred through different kinds of experimental data that are then interpreted through models of how the population may have grown over time that may or may not be correct. And therefore, the measurements or estimations of mutation rates that we have are therefore relatively rough estimates. This other kind of question of asking what's the distribution of the fitness effects, like what's the probability you're going to have a positive mutation, a neutral mutation, or a negative mutation, that still essentially is unknown. It's with the current technologies that we have, it's at least extremely difficult to determine what this distribution of fitness effects is. All right, so today what I'm going to do is talk about, yes, please. Yeah.
I can imagine cases where you can have a mutation which is neutral immediately after it happens, but yeah, maybe might become positive or negative,
right,
by a successive mutation, for example.
Right.
I mean, so when you say these things, are you careful about whether it's the immediate effect of the change or whether you're looking at the long term, for example.
Okay, that's a really good point. So when you talk about complex organisms like ourselves, what exactly is neutral and positive negative is, like you say, not necessarily obvious. But a lot of the experiments that I'm going to talk about tomorrow and a few of the ones I'm going to talk about today involve E. coli. And it turns out that for E. coli, it's actually very simple, right? So if you have, so what a positive mutation would correspond to for E. coli is just a mutation that results in them able to grow faster. And if they're able to grow faster, that means they're going to generate more offspring and therefore increase their prevalence in the population. So for something like E. coli, what these actually mean, I would say, is well defined. It's essentially, does this speed up their growth rate, do nothing to their growth rate, or slow it down? Now, when you start interpreting these results for more complex things like ourselves, I would imagine that you'd have to be a lot more careful about exactly what you mean.
Even for things like E. coli,
mm-hmm.
Imagine you have to make 3 changes to really like ramp up in growth rate.
Yep.
Like let's say you have 3 mutations.
That's right.
In 3 different places. At the end of which you will get a huge fitness benefit or whatever it may be.
That's
but
right.
It might not necessarily be true that when you make the first step that you walk forwards like a third of the way or something like that.
That's right.
You take another step in this right. mutational space and you go another third. And then finally, when you take the last third, you're done. And that's sort of what was confusing me is that it might not immediately be obvious after just one mutation, whether it was positive or neutral or negative. You might have to, even for things like E. coli, might have to look at them contingent on the history that those are coming from.
That's true as well. That's right. So you can also get interactions between mutations that affect what their effect on the organism is going to be. But to a first approximation, what I mean when I say this is to think about the individual mutations by themselves. So in the kind of scenario that you mentioned, I would say like the first 2 mutations would be neutral, and then the third one would be something positive. But now whether that's like a rigorous definition that would hold up to scrutiny, that's another question. Yeah, we got another question back here. I'm sorry?
So you said that we have to be more careful when we're dealing with complex organisms, the effect of what mutation would do.
Right.
So is it that we don't know the dependence of growth rate on the mutation, or is it that the optimizing principle is not maximization of growth rate?
So I would say for a human, something complex like ourselves, I mean, what you even mean by positive and negative and neutral is not necessarily well defined. So, I mean, you could have some mutation that, you know, gives you X-ray vision or something that makes you, makes you a happier person, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to generate more offspring, right? So you have to be careful about what exactly you're talking about when you say you're measuring fitness and what these mutations do to that fitness. Okay. Anything else? Yeah, punkage.
How much can you separate this from background? Right? So you're assuming that mutations are independent.
Yeah.
So,
to a first approximation, just to get a first estimation of what the mutation rates are, you assume that they're independent. And then any kind of higher order interactions, that's just going to make the problem even more complicated and difficult, right? So. For a first attempt, we're not going to worry about those. Okay? All right. Anything else? All right. So let's talk about how you estimate these rates and what they do to the organism. Now, I should also mention that back when people first started thinking about this, there was quite a bit of controversy, and actually there still is quite a bit of controversy about how it is that these mutations arise. Okay, so the question is, do these mutations arrive spontaneously and randomly? Or, as a consequence of their interaction with the environment, can the environment feed back and affect essentially what the mutation rate is and which genes are mutated in the organism? And so whether or not this link exists is still pretty controversial. I would say currently a lot of the evidence seems to suggest that there are circumstances in which you can get environmental feedback that affects the mutation rates. A lot of the experiments I'm going to show you today and quantification of mutation rates I'll show you today are examples where it does not appear that you get any kind of environmental feedback, that everything is just completely random. What I'm going to show you tomorrow is an explicit and direct example of a measurement where this definitely does exist. Okay? All right, so how do we measure these mutation rates and how can we tell what they do to the organism? So it turns out that measuring mutation is very difficult because most of the detection methods that we currently use in experimental biology are indirect. Okay, so what I mean by that is, I mentioned this briefly yesterday, but if you look at these E. coli, you can't tell just by looking at them, like is this guy genetically different than this guy? You can't really tell just by looking, right? There's not necessarily any outward change in their appearance that indicates that they've undergone some kind of mutation. So how do we detect mutations? So generally, experimentally, the way that we do this is as a result of changes in their phenotype. Okay, so for example, when they undergo mutations, they can start to metabolize different sugars that are available in the environment, or maybe they'll become immune to some virus or something, in the example I'm about to give you in a second. Or maybe it just affects their growth rate, right? So maybe we can put them under the microscope and measure how fast they grow and then determine whether or not they've had a mutation through how fast they grow. But in particular, these kinds of mutations, the neutral mutations, where you get changes to the genomic information that don't do anything. So, I mean, what is meant by a neutral mutation is a mutation that has no outward effect on the phenotype, okay? So essentially, if you're trying to detect mutations through changes in the phenotype, you will never measure these kinds of neutral mutations. And our current estimates is that these really are the most prevalent kinds of mutations that occur in the organism. So if you're doing these kinds of experiments where you're looking at growth rates or you're looking at resistance to antibiotics or resistance to viruses, you simply will never see these. Okay, and if you can't measure one giant class of the kinds of mutations that you have, you know, then your estimate of the mutation rates is not going to be all that great. Now, another method that is currently becoming more and more popular as it's becoming more powerful and cheaper is that you can also do sequencing, right? So you can just grow up a population of bacteria and then just do whole genome sequencing and see, you know, directly what are the sequences of these organisms' genomes. Okay, so this is relatively powerful, but I would say the problem with this is that it's very difficult to get any kind of dynamics or kinetic information. And if you want to measure rates, essentially what you have to do is take samples over time and sequence those. And that turns out to be still relatively expensive. And also, you have to get a very, very deep sequencing coverage to be able to determine what the genomic sequence is of every organism that's in your population. So I would say that determining mutation rates through these kinds of methods are still up and coming, okay? All right, so what people have done primarily so far is these kinds of experiments that involve measuring the cell's phenotype. Okay, and the classic experiment through which this was done is called the Luria-Delbruck experiment. Okay, so the point of the Luria-Delbruck experiment was, so their primary question that they were asking was whether or not they could detect this kind of environmental feedback. And also as a result of performing this experiment, they could also then, through models of how their population grew, they could also infer what the mutation rates were that were involved in this experiment. Okay, so let me first of all describe for you how the experiment was set up. So these are the two guys, Luria and Max Delbruck. And so the experiment that they came up with involved using E. coli, just like these little guys up here. Okay, now it turns out that E. coli have predators, right? So there are viruses that attempt to attack and kill E. coli and use the E. coli to make more virus particles of that are just like themselves. Okay, so these little viruses, they really look exactly like little hypodermic needles. Okay, so these viruses will float around in the medium and eventually they'll bind to the membrane of the E. coli. And it turns out that to recognize and bind to the membrane of the E. coli requires a specific protein that the E. coli always express under normal conditions. Okay, so this protein is normally used as like some kind of sugar transporter or something to bring food inside the cell, but this virus has co-opted it to use it as a receptor to recognize, to bind to the exterior of the cell. Okay, so what happens is the virus comes in, it recognizes this receptor and it binds to it, and then the virus squirts its DNA inside the E. coli cell. That DNA then gets incorporated into the cell's genome. Right, so now I've got viral DNA incorporated into my genome. And then it uses the E. coli cellular machinery in order to read the genes that are encoded on that viral genome to produce more virus particles. Okay, so as these genes are read, you produce more and more viruses, until eventually you produce enough viruses that the cell pops open and releases all the viruses that have been made. Okay, does that make sense? All right, but now what this means is that in order for the virus to do this to the cell has got to produce this membrane protein. So if you get some kind of mutation that results in a cell that does not express this membrane protein, then they're not going to be able to be infected by the viruses, and therefore they're going to be immune to any sort of viral attack. Okay? All right, so now what Lurie and Delbruck wanted to see was that this kind of mutation in this protein receptor, whether or not these mutations arose spontaneously and randomly, or whether those mutations arose as a result of the fact that the cells recognized that they had this kind of viral attack going on. Okay, so what they did was to they can subject the cells to the viral attack and then measure what the statistics are of the appearance of these mutations. All right, and it turns out that if this mutation is random and spontaneous, or if it's sensitive to the environment, that the kind of statistics that you'll expect for the production of these immune cells is going to be radically different. Okay? And so I can show you exactly what I mean by that. Okay, so these are some examples of what's referred to as a phylogenetic tree. All right, so what they do is they take a tube that's filled with medium that the cells will use to grow, and then ideally what you would do would be to inoculate this food with just a single cell. Okay, and so that single founding cell of that population is what's indicated by this single circle at the top of each one of these trees. And then over time, the single cell is going to grow, and then eventually it's going to divide into two daughter cells, like this. Okay, so that's what you're looking at with these trees, is the growth of one cell into a whole population down here. Okay, so every time you go through a generation, a doubling of the cells, you're going to produce more cells. Okay? So you start with one cell, you wind up with a large population of cells at the end of the experiment. All right, now, so what Lurie and Delbruck recognized was that if the mutations arise spontaneously in this tree, which you can see over here, so As the cells grow and divide, they can generate mutations at every branch in that tree. Every cell can potentially have a random spontaneous mutation. And here, just for example, I've colored them with different colors to indicate whether it's positive or neutral or negative that kills them. Okay, so you can see that if they're random, they can occur at any point in that tree. If instead they occur in response to some sort of environmental stimulus, then in the most ideal situation, what you would expect is this. Okay, so the population, the cells would grow and divide, and you wouldn't get any mutations until the final generation when you actually expose them to this environmental stimulus. Okay, and then in the most ideal situation, once they sense this environmental stimulus, which I've indicated with this gray dashed line, if the cells are really, really good at this game, then all of the mutations that they generate will be beneficial. Now, you can imagine scenarios where that's, you know, you'll still get some mixture of beneficial or neutral or negative. But in the most ideal situation, this is what you would get. All right, so now if you look, so now what they measure when they do this experiment is they let the cells grow into this big population down here at the end, and then they hit them with the phage, or with the virus, okay? And then they let the virus attack the cells, and then they take the cells and they plate them on an auger plate. Okay? So they take this ending population, and then they take it and they spread it on a solid medium plate. Any cells which have not generated this mutation to make them immune are going to die, right? So they're going to get killed by the virus, and therefore they're not going to be able to grow on this plate. Any cells which have undergone this mutation will be able to survive. And then once they land on this plate, then they're going to grow and form colonies. Okay, so any cells that become immune, they're going to grow on this plate. And then you can count and see how many immune cells resulted as a result of this exposure to the virus. Does this all make sense? Yes.
Generation.
That's the idea, yes.
But then the G5 both should look identical.
Till the G5 generation,
mm-hmm.
both of them should look identical, right?
What do you mean by, so you mean this should look the same as this?
Yeah,
No, that's not true. So I think what you can see just by looking at it is that, so maybe the average mutation rate may look the same, but when you look at the higher order moments of the distribution, it's actually going to look significantly different.
But what is different between the A and B before you put the virus?
So before you put the virus, absolutely nothing. Before you put the virus, it's just a population that's growing in the tube. And then the question is, while they're growing in the tube, are they accumulating mutations? Or do they not generate any mutations while they're growing until they're hit with the virus? Okay, so you see over here in this column, you don't get any mutations until this very last generation.
These are not experimental observations, these are expectations.
That's right. This is what you would expect. This is what you would expect if the mutations arise as a result of being sensitive to the environment. This is the kind you would expect from random spontaneous mutation.
One more thing, the yes. mutations in this case will make the bacteria immune to the virus.
That's right.
But then it will not allow it to take in the nutrients.
Ah, so then all you have to do is just grow them in an environment where they're not dependent upon whatever it is this protein normally does. Okay. All right, so if you look at these trees, you can see that you're going to expect significantly different distributions in the number of immune colonies depending upon how the generation or how the mutations arise. Right? So over here, since the mutations arise with some rate only in response to being hit with this environmental stimulus, then every time you do the experiment, you'll expect within some noise approximately the same number of immune bacteria. Yeah. So I'm just saying that this is like this is two extremes of a spectrum, right? So this is if the mutations are only environmentally sensitive. I mean, you could have some combination of that, but just to have the ultimate distinguishability between the two, I showed only environmentally sensitive and only spontaneous.
It could also be like there is random mutation and the environment can cause it to create a positive mutation.
That's right. So there, it could be some superposition of these two circumstances. That's right. Okay. So in this case, where they're perfectly environmentally sensitive, you would expect approximately the same number of immune cells every time. Whereas over here, you can see that you get wildly fluctuating numbers of immune cells. So, for example, you can imagine an experiment where the very first cell that you put in the tube is has already generated some mutation that makes it immune to the bacteria or immune to the virus. And if this first guy is already immune as a result of some random mutation, then every single cell down here is going to be immune, and you're going to get a ton of colonies. And this ton of colonies as a result of some early prior mutation is what's called a jackpot. You had a question. That's right. That's right. So what this experiment is saying is that once they see the phage, they then take that as a signal that they need to generate mutations in order to counteract that phage. Yep. The way this experiment is designed, that would be the way it would have to work. So, and it's, I would say that that's actually a weakness and a limitation of this experiment, that what they're using is a lethal phage. Yeah, so that's actually a really good point and is a weakness of this experiment. Yes? So a phage, it actually doesn't matter what the concentration is. As long as you get phage infecting the cell, it's going to die. Okay, so if this virus is essentially 100% lethal. Now, you can imagine repeating this experiment with like some other kind of environmental insult, like a antibiotic or something, and using sublethal concentrations of the antibiotic. And there are certainly people who are currently trying to do such things. Their results are, I would say at this point, inconclusive. Okay, anything else?
Right when it gets infected by the virus, then it doesn't have the time to make the mutation, right?
Yeah, that's again, I would say, is another weakness of this experiment. So, I mean, these guys won the Nobel Prize for doing this experiment, but as you have already pointed out, there are holes in this experiment. And that's why people are still performing experiments to see whether or not there is this sort of environmental feedback, because they have realized, just as you guys have, that this is not an airtight argument. Okay? This was in the 40s, like 43? 43. Yeah, so it was a long time ago. Okay, anything else? All right, so the whole point of this experiment is that you look at the fluctuations away from the mean, right? So if you have random spontaneous mutations, the number of immune colonies that you're going to get from experiment to experiment is going to fluctuate wildly. Whereas if it's perfectly environmentally responsive, you'll essentially get the same thing every time. And of course, when they did the experiment, what they found was this, that you can get these kinds of jackpots where some experiments you get a ton of immune colonies as a result of a very early spontaneous mutation. And then the number of immune cells that you see, it varies dramatically from experiment to experiment. And so what that says is that there is some process going on where you have spontaneous random background mutations. Now, somebody else in the audience pointed out, that doesn't necessarily mean that this is not also going on, but this experiment, as others have pointed out, is not necessarily sufficient to rule this out completely. But it does say that at least this is going on, okay? Now, so when you do an experiment like this, essentially all you see is the ending set. You can measure how many cells are in your ending population, and you can measure how many cells are in your starting population. But all of this information that's contained in how the population grows over time, you don't actually get to see any of this unless you actually put it under the microscope. And even if you put it under the microscope, it may not be necessarily obvious where these mutations occur. So if you want to use this kind of information to extract what a mutation rate may have been, then what you have to do is write down models that describe what you think this tree looks like, okay? And then that model is going to be based on assumptions about how you think that population behaves, which may or may not be correct, okay? So once you've got this model for how you think this tree evolved over time, you can then use the frequency of mutations that you see in the final population to then extract what the mutation rate must have been if your model of that population growth was correct. Okay? So these kinds of numbers that I gave you yesterday of like one base and 10 to the 10th, it's through these kinds of models and estimation of rates through those models that those kinds of numbers were developed. Okay? All right, so any questions about Luria Delbrook? All right, so then let me give you some, yeah. Yes. Yeah, yeah, I would say that is certainly true, that I think it's essentially a fatal flaw in this experiment, that once the cells are infected, they're dead. They don't have time to generate this resistance. So, I mean, essentially, I would say that a lot of the premise that their experiment is based on is not correct. Okay? And like I said, that's also why people are still doing these kinds of experiments, to see whether or not they can suss this kind of thing out. Okay, so now let me give you some more examples of these kinds of experiments and another variety of statistical analysis that you can perform on the sorts of data that we actually have access to in order to extract mutation rates. Okay, so what we've been talking about so far is just things like point mutations in E. coli and how that drives the evolution of the population. Okay, but in organisms like ourselves, mutations can have other effects too that can, in fact, be really quite bad. And one example of that kind of mutation is the sort of thing that results in cancer. Okay, so human cancer is a result of the accumulation of mutations in our cells as we grow and get older and get cancer. All right, so what you're looking at here is some data that was collected from the United Kingdom on the rate of incidence of colon cancer in women. All right, so if you look at this, so this is the incidence, the number of people who get colon cancer per 100,000 people as a function of how old they are. Now, when you look at this curve, a few things I would say are immediately obvious. First of all, there's not a lot of young people that get cancer, right? So there's a gap here, there's a lag of about 40 or 50 years before people actually start getting cancer. And then once this thing kicks on, you get an exponential increase in the number of people who get cancer as a function of how old they are. Okay, here's another example set of data. So this is cigarette use in the United States from 1900 to 2002. And I actually find this graph pretty interesting because you can see a lot of cool things going on here. So you can see that initially, you know, there's not a whole lot of smoking going on. And then First World War, you smoke them if you got them, right? So the rate of smoking goes up quite a bit in the First World War. Then we've got the Roaring Twenties here. Then you get the Depression and people stop smoking. And then here, these guys really earned their cigarettes. This is World War II. And so then what people noticed is that as the rate of smoking went up, that something bad was happening, right? So they noticed that as the rate of smoking went up, if you look at the rate of lung cancer in men and women, that it also started to go up as well. And the amount of correlation between the rate of smoking and the rate of lung cancer is, I would say this is pretty frightening, right? Now, so if you look at these data, you see features that are kind of similar to what we saw in the last plot. Specifically, so like here, if you look at the peak in cigarette consumption, and correlate that with the peak in the cancer rate, again, you see that there's this lag of several years. I guess this is about 30 years. Okay, so again, you see a lag. Okay, so what that says is that these people start smoking, and then on the order of 30 to 40 years pass, and then after that lag, then they start to develop cancer. Here's another example. These are some men. I believe this is some kind of miner. I don't remember exactly what they were mining. But in the process of doing their job, they are exposed to this chemical called 2-naphthalamine. This plot is also, I would say, pretty horrifying. Okay, so the different curves on this plot correspond to people who have been working at this job for various amounts of time. So this is people who worked for more than 5 years, this is someone who was only mining for 3 to 4 years, and this is somebody who was, they were just a temp or something. Okay, so now again, this is the rate of bladder cancer as a function of exposure to naphthalamine. And you can see that these poor guys that have been exposed to it for more than 5 years, almost all of them develop cancer. Okay, and again, you can see that there's this lag between the exposure and when the cancer actually starts to grow. So all these types of cancer seem to show the same sort of phenomenology. Okay, so you're exposed to some sort of chemical, and then after some lag time, that chemical causes you to get cancer. So the obvious question is, where does this lag come from? Yes? Ah, so that's a, so I would say that that's what you're looking at here, right? So you can see these guys, they were exposed to it for a significantly shorter amount of time than those, and what that does is effectively decrease the lag and also the percentage of the people which it affects. So you should do that if you have the option, to stop being exposed to carcinogens. All right, so this is the hypothesis for why you see this lag in the development of cancer. That's what's happening is that what's causing the cancer is that you're accumulating mutations in your cells, and eventually it takes some amount, there are specific genes in your cells that are responsible for causing the cancer, and it just takes time to accumulate the necessary mutation in those genes to generate the cancer. Make sense? All right, so now, because we're diploid organisms, that means we have two copies of every chromosome in our cell, or two copies of every gene in our in every cell that we have. You can imagine different scenarios for which this could happen. One is that, so this is an example of what's called an overactivity mutation. That's where you only need to get a single mutation in a single gene, and that the hyperactivity of that one single mutation is enough to result in the development of cancer. So this would be what you would call a one-hit cancer. It only requires one hit to give you cancer. Another possibility is that you have some kind of gene which suppresses cancer in the cell. And as long as you have one functioning copy of that suppressive gene, you're still not going to get cancer. So in that case, what would happen would be you'd have to accumulate two hits, okay? And until you knock out both of those genes, you're not going to get cancer, okay? And so what I'm going to show you is that just as Luria Delbruck did, that by analyzing those kinds of statistics that I showed you at a couple slides ago, you can determine how many genes are involved in generating the cancer, and you can extract the rates at which the mutations occur that cause that cancer. All right, so now, in order to extract that kind of information, just like I said for the Luria Delbruck experiment, you have to write down some kind of model for how you think the population is going to evolve and then interpret your data through that model. You have to do exactly the same thing for these kinds of data. All right, so we have this idea that we have specific genes that need to be mutated in order to generate cancer. And so what I'm going to do is describe a model for random mutation of genes and then use that model to predict how you would expect the frequency of cancer to change over time. All right, so this kind of analysis is what's called target theory, and as I'll explain, this is an example of what's called a Poisson process. All right, so what I've got drawn down here is a schematic representation of your genome, where each one of these gene or each one of these boxes represents a gene in your genome. Now, not every gene in your genome is going to be related to whether or not you get cancer. So only one of them, say this guy, is going to be what I'm going to call a cancer gene. All right, so now what's going to happen is that as we live our lives, we're going to accumulate mutations. So we're going to get strikes on our genome. Now you can imagine these strikes coming from a variety of different kinds of sources. They can result just from random mutational errors, random replication errors, like we talked about yesterday. They can come about as a result of environmental mutagens like UV or naphthalamine or cigarette smoke. So what exactly these strikes are doesn't really matter. What does matter is that they occur randomly. In other words, that they have a constant probability per unit length to strike anywhere on the genome. And I'm also going to assume that they occur at a constant rate. Just as an example, say one strike per second. Okay, so now what I'm going to say is that after some amount of time t, we're going to have some amount of genome strikes in. Now, as I talked about yesterday, just from replication errors, so the human genome is about 3 × 10⁹ base pairs long, and so just from replication errors, you can still accumulate a significant number of mutations. And then also the amount of environmental factors that we experience every day, from like UV rays to different kinds of chemicals, that means that this number is actually going to be quite large. Okay, so the number of strikes that we experience to our genome is going to be pretty big. The probability that one of these strikes hits this cancer gene is what I'm going to call P. Okay, so now if this is the model, we can use this model to answer this question. What's the probability of getting cancer as a function of how old you are? In other words, we're going to try to explain these curves and then extract these mutation rates that are responsible for this. Or another way to state this more mathematically is like this. As a function of time, what's the probability that you have gotten M number of strikes to the cancer genes that you're interested in? Okay, now, this, given the conditions that I described for you previously, that it's completely random and it occurs at a constant rate, this probability of M strikes is given by binomial distribution. You guys are familiar with this, I hope. So this just simply says that if you have P cancers, or if you have M strikes to a cancer gene and that occurs with probability P, then all the other strikes will occur to things that are not cancer genes, so this is all the other strikes. And then the order in which that occurs doesn't matter, so these are just the different combinations of ways that you can get these different kinds of strikes. Okay, so everybody has seen this before, yes? Okay. All right, so this is the answer to this question. But because of the conditions that I told you about, specifically that N is very big, and as I'm going to show you in a second, we expect P to be very small, there are easier ways to express this. Okay, so we know that our genome is huge. So the human genome, like I said, is about 3 × 10⁹ base pairs. And individual genes compared to that overall length are pretty small. So what that means is that P is very small. It's approximately zero. In other words, this drawing, this cartoon of my genome is not to scale. It looks more something like this, that the target that you're trying to hit is really tiny. The other thing we know is, as I described, N is going to be very big. Now, because of the nature of our system, we can't directly measure how many strikes we're getting to our genome. We don't know how many, you know, X-ray or UV photons we're absorbing per day. So you can't necessarily directly measure N. And it's also not necessarily obvious that you can reliably measure what P is. What you can measure is the kind of data that I showed you on those previous slides. You can measure what the rate is at which people get cancer. All right, so what you can measure is the rate at which people get cancer. Okay? And what I'm going to say is that that's equal to the probability per unit time of getting a cancer strike. Now, expressed in terms of the total lifetime of the organism, T, and the total number of strikes that you get. So what I'm going to do is everywhere in my binomial distribution, I'm going to replace P by just rearranging this equation and replace it with the rate times time. And then I'm going to take this limit that N is very big. Okay? So if I make this substitution in here, you get this. Okay? And then I'm going to take the limit that N is very huge. And I'm not going to bore you with the details, because I suspect a lot of you have probably seen this before. But essentially, just use a couple very simple mathematical tricks. One is that when N gets very big, it gets very hard to calculate factorials. And so you can approximate the factorials with what's called Stirling's approximation, which looks something like this, neglecting some constants out front. And you can also use this definition of E. Okay, so you can see that that looks an awful lot like that. So you're going to get factors of E showing up. And when you make these substitutions and you take these limits, what you wind up with is this equation, which is called the Poisson distribution, which you may have seen previously. Has everybody here seen this before? Anybody not seen this before? Okay, that's good. Ah, there's one. Okay, that's good. So I'm not wasting my time. That's great. All right, so now this thing. So what this allows you to do is you can watch your organism over time, T. Okay, and then you can use the Poisson distribution to predict the, you know, how many cancer gene strikes, M, are you going to get as a function of time, T. But now this Poisson distribution is extremely useful. It's applicable to a whole variety of different kinds of systems, even beyond cancer or even biological problems. Anytime you have any kind of process where you have some small constant rate that determines the rate at which the process evolves, and that the events that you're interested in are random and independent of one another, anything that satisfies these constraints, which is a whole lot of problems, is going to obey this Poisson distribution. So this anything that obeys this Poisson distribution is what's called a Poisson process. And like I said, this is a whole lot of very important things. Yes? That's right. Yeah, exactly. So what we're assuming here is that there's one specific gene, and in particular, one specific kind of mutation in that gene that will generate cancer. So what we're going to extract from this kind of analysis is what is the rate at which that one specific kind of mutation occurs. That's exactly right. So all this other stuff like neutral mutations or even beneficial, you just have no idea. And again, that's why this is so hard, is because, you know, how are you going to determine what that is from this? You have to have some sort of external phenotype to be able to measure it. All right. Okay, so what I just showed is that if you take this binomial distribution and you take this limit of large N and small p, you get a Poisson distribution. Just to make a nice complete story, if p is also large, what you wind up getting is a normal or a Gaussian distribution. Okay, so now let's take this model and let's apply it to these kinds of cancer data that I showed you previously. All right, so I believe this is the first example of somebody applying this kind of quantitative analysis to the development of cancer to extract what these kinds of mutation rates are that are responsible for this. Okay, so this was this guy Knudsen, published this back in 1971. And the kind of cancer that he was looking at was something called retinoblastoma. Okay, brace yourselves. Oh, not yet. Okay, so retinoblastoma, as the name may imply, it's a cancer of the eye. So this is what the human eye looks like. Okay, so what happens is light comes in here through the lens and then is collected on the retina at the back. So the cells at the back that are actually absorb and collect the light to interpret as images by your brain, This layer of cells is what's called the retina. And so what a retinoblastoma is a cancer of these retinal cells at the back of the eye. And it usually occurs in infants. So usually what happens is that if you're going to get it, you get it as a little tiny baby, which is kind of horrible. But, you know, nature is cruel. Okay, here's what it looks like. Sorry to do this. So this is, I'm afraid, a little kid's eyeball. And so here's the actual tumor that arises. That's the phenotype of this cancer. And so what they do is the poor little kids that get this disease, they have to cut their eyes out in order to prevent this from killing them. Okay, so this is an example. Now, different kids can present this disease in a variety of different ways. So you can have only one eye affected. That phenotype is what's called a unilateral. Okay, you can also have kids that get tumors in both eyes. That's called bilateral. And then those poor guys then have to have both their eyeballs removed. Yeah. Excuse me? It is hereditary. So, and I'll show you quantitative evidence that it's hereditary in a second. Anything else?
Are there external triggers?
Yes, there are. Exactly what those external triggers are, we don't know, but generally they occur during the actual development of the retina while the kid's still in the womb. So whatever the mutation is that occurs, it occurs while they're still developing, and then once they're born, these tumors can start to accumulate. Okay, now this is pretty horrible, so just to cleanse the visual palette, here's a puppy. Okay. All right, so now let's use this mathematical model to try to extract what the rate is at which these tumors occur. And then, as I'll show you, we can also then use these data to determine how many genes are responsible for causing this kind of cancer. All right, so what this guy did was plot as a function of age, what is the fraction of patients who did not have tumors. Okay, so what that means is that he had some collection of kids, which they know after some amount of time they did eventually get this cancer. And so then what they're plotting here on this axis is how old, this is essentially the survival probability of cancer. So it's going to start out here. All the kids are going to start out with no cancer, and then over time it's going to decrease as they develop the cancer. All right, so now let's try to figure out what we would expect this curve to look like. All right, so here's our Poisson distribution. If I can remember what it is, it's kt to the m e to the minus kt over m factorial. Okay, now, I'm going to caution you. Yes? I'm sorry?
This retinoblastoma,
yes,
tends to occur more often in kids, right?
That's right.
So that right away tells you that, you know, whatever you expect from the theory which we built, you know, till now, shouldn't work simply because the strikes are, you know, you will accumulation of strikes increase with time, mm-hmm, whereas you are talking about a disease which occurs predominantly in kids.
That's right.
So which by default, you know, by definition of kids, they basically have lived shorter than adults. So
that's right. So I mean, I don't think you can say a priori that this curve is necessarily going to follow this prediction. I mean, you can say that, you know, as it seems obvious that as a function of time, the kids are going to develop cancer, but it's not necessarily obvious that it's going to quantitatively be described by this distribution. I don't know if that answers your question or not.
I mean, explain the whole process. I mean, because you see, you're talking about a disease which cancer,
yeah,
which is more common in children,
yeah,
who are lived shorter than like adults, basically. I mean,
well, so so then what that means is that the rate at which it occurs for the kids is higher, right? So it, since the kids live for a shorter amount of time than most people, then that means that whatever the rate at which these mutations accumulate, it must be faster than for these other kinds of cancers where it takes them 60 or 70 years to generate it, right? So that's one of the things that makes this kind of cancer amenable to this kind of analysis, is I think because the rate is so high. I don't know if that answers the question or not, but okay. All right, so now I'm going to warn you that the first time you see this reasoning, it may sound a little bit circular, but if you write it down and think through it, it actually makes a lot of sense. So first, let's ask, what's the probability a cancer gene gets no strikes? Okay, so that is P of M equals zero. That's E to the minus KT. Okay, so then, so this is the probability that a cancer gene gets no strikes. So then, what's the probability that a cancer gene gets one or more strikes? Okay, so probability is, you know, when you integrate over all probabilities, that's equal to 1. So this is essentially every other possibility besides this one. And so this probability, P of M greater than or equal to 1, is 1 minus. Yeah. I'll show you in a second that there is a component of heredity to it. I'll show you what happens in a second, okay? So there is a component of heredity, but there's also a component of de novo mutations being generated from the environment. So there's both of these things going on. Okay, so now, let's imagine that, so this is just if you have one cancer gene. What if you have multiple cancer genes? Let's say you have N cancer genes. Then what's the probability that N cancer genes get struck one or more times? So each of those genes is going to be independent of one another. And therefore, the probability N genes are struck one or more times is just this raised to the power of n. Right? Okay, so now we're calculating what's the probability that these genes have been struck. So these people are going to get cancer. That's not what we're going to plot, though. We're going to plot the people who have not yet got cancer. Okay, so then the question is, what's the probability that N genes have not been struck one or more times? I'm sorry? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I'll try to write bigger. Okay, so now the reasoning is just like this. It's 1 minus this curve. So this curve that I'm going to plot here is what's called the survival probability. Okay, so the survival probability is just 1 minus this number. Okay? Yeah. Just take this and multiply it to the power n. So that would give you the probability that uh, I would have to, I'm going to have to think through this to tell you, it's a little bit convoluted reasoning, but. Okay, so now let's take this thing that we predict and see what it looks like. So let's plot this curve for different values of n as a function of time. And what you see is, so if you just have one cancer gene, if this is the log of the survival probability, you'll just get a straight line. If it's one cancer gene, what you'll see is a lag, right? So you see a lag and then exponential decrease. And it turns out that the size of this lag, how long the lag is, depends upon the number of cancer genes that are involved. And if you take this exponential increase and extract it back like so to see where the intercept is, it turns out that where that line intercepts the y-axis tells you exactly what n is, what the number of genes are. Okay? All right, so now, when Knudsen applied this to the data for retinoblastoma, this is what he got. So what you see here are two different curves. And what these, so you can, it's maybe a little hard for you guys to see, but so these data sets, these are squares, and that corresponds to the bilateral cases, that is the kids who get tumors in both eyes. And these are circles, which are the kids who are the unilateral cases. They just have tumors in one eye. Okay, so this is exactly this plot I showed you on the previous. This is log of the survival probability as a function of time. And you can see that there's two different curves. This one looks like a straight line. So that's just e to the minus kt. That tells you that there's only one target. This curve is this, where n is equal to 2. What this tells you is that there's two different kinds of kids that can get cancer. Okay, so this is where the hereditary element comes into play. All right, so what's going on here is this. So the kids who are getting bilateral, that is tumors in both eyes, what's happened is that because they're diploid organisms, the genes that they get that control this retinoblastoma, they've already gotten one bad copy of that gene from one of their parents. So they've only got one functional copy of the retinoblastoma gene. Okay, and this just describes the amount of time that it takes to knock that remaining copy back out. These kids who get a unilateral retinoblastoma, you can see that the exponent up here is 2. That means that when they're born, they have both of their retinoblastoma genes are intact, and they have to get 2 hits in order to knock out both copies before they get retinoblastoma. And you can also see from looking at this curve, the slope, if you just extract the slope of that curve, you can determine exactly what the rate of that mutation is. Okay? Does this make sense? All right, cool.
Which one related to loss of function and the upper curve related to gain of function?
I'm sorry, say that one more time.
This graph, this line related to loss of function and this graph related to gain of function?
They're both loss of function. Both of these are loss of function. These guys, so you have 2 copies of this gene. This guy only has 1 good copy, right? So they already inherited 1 bad copy from their parents. And so they only had to knock out the 1 remaining good copy to get the cancer. These guys, they were born with 2 good copies. So they had to get both copies knocked out. Did that answer the question? Okay. So there's 1 gene, but there's 2 alleles. There's 2 copies of that gene because we're diploid organisms. Does everybody know what diploid means? Yeah, so diploid just means that every gene that you have, you actually have 2 copies of that gene, right? Because we have essentially 2 copies of our genome in our cells. Yes? Mm-hmm. Yes. So, yes, that's right. So the bilateral cases essentially completely arise as a result of these guys who have already inherited 1 bad copy from their parents. You essentially don't see any bilateral cases that come from these kids.
This analysis can't say how much n is, right? N could be 1 and
2. So in this, yes, that's right. So I think what this analysis says is that one strike is sufficient to do it. But you can have multiple strikes and still get the same result. But one is enough to do it, is what this analysis says. That's right. So I think these particular data are from kids who they actually have some family history of having retinoblastoma. That's possible. Yes. That's possible. It's possible. Yes. That's possible. Yes. Okay. So now in the remaining minute, one more. Ah, no, that's not necessarily true. All that matters is, so again, we watch them. We essentially know what the endpoint is, right? We know, we've watched the kids grow up, so we know eventually whether or not they get tumors in both eyes or not. They don't necessarily have to arise at the same time. The only question is whether or not eventually they get tumors in both eyes. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. That's, yeah, so like I said, these mutations primarily occur during development while the kid is still in the womb. So I think what you say is essentially right, but it's, I think that's right. Yes. Yes.
Inherited both mutations? Like mutations on both.
So the kids who inherit both mutations, they're definitely going to get bilateral retinoblastoma. Right?
But there's no data for that?
So I think with them, I mean, for them, it's essentially going to be zero lag, right? As soon as they come out of the womb, I think they're essentially going to have it. So I think essentially they're not going to show up on this graph, I think. Okay, I want to actually move on and show you guys some other stuff. Okay, so this lag explains, or at least qualitatively agrees with these kinds of data for these other kinds of cancers that we saw. Okay, so now what? So this kind of analysis and calculation of survival probability is predicated on the assumption of randomness and independence of the mutation events. So anytime you have some kind of random independent mutations in your organism, you can expect it to be governed by this kind of Poisson distribution, or described by this Poisson distribution. If you have some kind of mutational process that is not necessarily explicitly described by this, that means that something else interesting is going on. All right, also, this analysis that we performed is over time. It's temporal randomness. Yes, you had a question.
So when you're trying to do this, you have when you're fitting these curves, you have K and N as free parameters, right?
That's right. So K tells you the slope,
yeah,
and then N tells you what the y-intercept of when you extrapolate that line back to the y-axis, N is going to tell you what that intercept is.
So so if you go back to the one gene and the two gene curves.
Yeah.
No, it is just one step ahead of this for the retinoblastoma data. Do those use the same K? Do both of them use the same K?
Approximately, yes. So I mean, the K on the semi-log plot, you can see it essentially just from the slope of these lines, and you can see that the slope of this and the slope of this are approximately the same.
Okay, and for example, this might be a stupid question, but how far can you get by, for example, fitting N equals 3 with a slightly different K or something like that?
Oh. Well, so I think, so from these data, so I mean, what you're looking at is the mutation of this one gene, right? So, I mean, the fact that you have this one curve here that is purely exponential, it kind of fixes what k is going to be. I mean, there's no reason to expect that different copies of the gene are going to have different k's. So I think this set of data essentially fixes what the k is. And once you've got this fixed, that you essentially have no freedom left to change what k and n are. Okay. All right, so what we talked about so far is temporal randomness. That is, events occurring randomly in time. There's also a question of when you have a population of cells that are spread out over space, whether or not the mutations also occur randomly in space. Okay? So the next thing I want to talk about is the same kind of analysis applied to mutations in space rather than time. And what you're going to see is it's described by exactly the same Poisson distribution, that if you have random mutations, you're going to expect them to be described by a Poisson distribution both in time and in space. Yes? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Wouldn't that affect the results? I mean, you know, like a retinoblastoma might be, why it affects kids more or less earlier could just be because those embryonic cells are like very fast dividing. Versus the lag that we see in tobacco cases and the other cases could be because it's in adults.
That's exactly right. So this particular kind of cancer, like I said, it primarily develops during development while those cells are rapidly dividing, whereas for these other types of cancers, that's not necessarily true. That the cells that make up your lungs are relatively quiescent. What's that?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's not exactly like how many times the cell has divided.
That's right. So I guess that K that we're extracting is not necessarily directly the mutation rate. It's like a mutation rate convolved with, you know, the rate at which the cells have divided. And I think it's so I actually gave you guys this paper to read. And if you try to read it, you'll see it's actually a pretty complicated piece of work. So I would suggest that if you're interested in those kinds of details, that to try to give it a look. Yeah.
But for the lung cancer, it's usually in the somatic cells. But for the retinoblastoma, the mutation is in the germline cells also, especially in the bilateral.
That's right. I think that's right. Yeah, so that's why it primarily occurs during development. Yes?
Mm-hmm. There's an inherent, because you're trying to infer the mutation rate from those curves, by fitting to those curves,
right. So you're inherently assuming that, you know, cancer treatment has no effect whatsoever.
Ah, yes. So that's right. I mean, these kinds of curves and these kinds of analysis, you know, if you take them seriously, that's the kind of data that you would have to have. Is, you know, you wouldn't complicate it by any kind of external treatment. So again, these kinds of analyses are very rough. They're just estimates of these rates. And again, I mean, I think this is an illustration of how difficult and complicated these things are. Yeah. That's right. Exactly. That's right. Yes. Okay, now let's talk about randomness in space. Okay, so again, I'm going to have the same, just as an introduction to the problem, we're still going to think about strikes on the genome, but rather than thinking about striking the genome over time, let's just think about where they strike the genome in space. So rather than worrying about this constant rate, let's just, you know, let the things all strike the genome at once, and then C is a function of position, where the strikes occurred. Okay, and the important part of this analysis, so again, what we're going to ask is after you have a certain number of strikes, what's the probability of M hits? But instead of thinking about this in time, we're going to think about how the strikes are distributed in space. Okay, so now the important thing for this analysis is that, again, the strikes are random. That is that the probability of striking the genome is constant per unit length. Okay, and what that means is that if you know the length of the genome and you know the length of the cancer gene, in principle, you should be able to estimate what that strike probability is. It's just the ratio of how big the cancer gene is in, relative to the rest of the genome. Okay, and then also, I think in the next slides, I'm going to replace, I'm going to write the average number of strikes to a cancer gene. I'm going to replace that with this parameter lambda just to make it easier to write down. Yes? Yeah, so it's not true. It's this is certainly not true. It's just a rough approximation and an introduction to the argument, I would say. But as we talked about yesterday, there are places where there are hot spots, so this is certainly not true. Okay, so what I've got here, I performed some MATLAB simulations of so you could essentially think of this as like a dartboard that I've divided up into several sub compartments, and then I'm just going to randomly throw strikes or darts or whatever you want to think of at this dartboard and see where they land. Okay. Now, so what I've got here is a two-dimensional target. So rather than thinking of the strike probability as being the length divided by the total length of the genome, then the strike probability in each one of these little squares you can calculate as delta A, which is the area of each little square, divided by the total area. Okay? So now the mean number of strikes that you're going to get per square is going to be equal to this probability of striking each square times the total number of strikes. Okay, so now this is a MATLAB simulation where I just took these little spots and just scattered them randomly on this XY plane. This is for 100 strikes, where the lambda, the mean number of strikes per square, is equal to 1. All right, so again, these spots are just distributed completely randomly. So now if you look at this, you can see that there's fluctuations in the number of spots that you get per little cell. So here, for example, this square has got 0 strikes. This square has got 4, maybe 5 strikes, depending upon how you count them. So now what you can do is generate a histogram of the number of squares that have a given number of strikes. Okay? And it looks like this. You'll have to excuse me, my labels on my x-axis here are wrong. You should take this number and then subtract 1. So this is the number of squares with 0 strikes, 1 strike, 2 strikes, so on and so forth. Okay, so these bars are generated from this actual random simulation that I did. And then this red curve is the theoretical expectation from the Poisson distribution with lambda equals 1. Okay, and so you can see that even in space, if you have a random process occurring in space, the number of strikes that you get distributed over space is also going to be described by this Poisson distribution. Okay, does that make sense? All right, now I also wanted to point out that in addition to the average, the mean of this distribution, you can also extract information from the width, the spread of the distribution. Okay, and the fact that we can write down explicitly what we expect the Poisson distribution to look like means that we can also explicitly calculate what its standard deviation is going to be. And what you see is that these are the standard deviations that you would expect if the process that you're looking at is the result of some random process. Okay, so if what you're looking at is a Poisson process, and you can measure the distribution of whatever events that you get, then it should follow these rules, that the variance, that is the square of the standard deviation, should be equal to the mean. Okay, so these relationships are characteristic of a random process. And if the process that you measure does not agree with these expectations, that means that it is not a purely random Poisson process. Okay? All right, so now, in the remaining minutes, let me give you an example of thinking about a Poisson process in space that generates mutations in bacteria. And so this is a procedure that we actually do in the lab that's called a viral transduction. So just like I told you with the Luria-Delbruck experiment, bacteria have these predators that are their viruses called bacteriophages. Okay, and they look like these little spaceship-like things. And so each of these viruses has a copy of its genome, and it can bind to each cell and inject its genome into the cell, like this. Okay, and then that viral genome can be incorporated into the cell's chromosome, like so. And in doing so, you have generated a mutation. You have changed the genetic information of that cell. Okay, and now all the viruses and all the bacteria are independent of one another. And what that means is that the probability that the virus is going to infect your cell is the same for every cell, and it's a constant. So in other words, this is a Poisson process. We expect this sort of binding and transduction to be random in space. All right, so now, why would you care? So now, like I said, we actually use this technique in the lab to generate strains of E. coli that have modifications to their genome. Okay, and knowing that it's a Poisson process, you can use that information to then tell you how to design your experiment to get various kinds of outcomes. So for example, if you perform this experiment in the lab, I can imagine two reasons why you would perform this experiment. One is that all the viruses that you have contain the same genome, and you want, so what, essentially what you want to do is to modify all of your bacteria with the same mutation. You want all the viruses to infect the cell and give them the same mutation. In other words, what you want to do is, in the tube that you have, you want to infect as many cells as you possibly can. Another possibility is that all the viruses are different. That is, you have like a library of viruses that contain different genetic information, and you want to use those viruses to change the genetic information of the cells that they infect in specific ways to see what the outcome of that mutation might be. Okay, in other words, when you infect the cells, you want to infect each cell only once. That is, you don't want to inject multiple mutations into the same cell. Does that make sense? Okay, so these are two possible experiments you might want to do in the lab. And what I'm going to show you is that by recognizing that this infection and transduction is a Poisson process, this will tell you how to set up your experiment. So, in particular, how much virus should you add to the cells in order to get these outcomes? Okay, so now, I showed you this previously, so now what you should think of is each one of these little squares is a cell that you want to infect, and each one of the little dots is a virus. Okay, so if you have a virus in a cell, what that corresponds to is that virus has bound to and infected that cell. Okay, and as we've described, this is going to be described by a Poisson process. And the mean number of viruses binding to each cell is going to be given by the ratio of the number of viruses that you add to the number of cells in your tube. This is, for the biologists, this is what's referred to as the multiplicity of infection. That is, the expected number of viruses per cell that will infect each cell. Okay, so now let's examine the two cases that we had in mind for our different experiments. The first one, the simplest one, is that where we want to infect as many cells as possible. Okay, stated mathematically, you can say something like this. We require, so P of zero is a cell getting infected by zero viruses. So 1 minus P of zero means that each cell has been infected one or more times. And so this condition, 1 minus P of zero is greater than 99%. This means that if we require this condition to be met, 99% of cells will be infected. They will be infected. Okay, so if you take this condition and you apply it to the Poisson distribution here, you can extract what this multiplicity of infection should be to get that result. And what you get is that you need to add between 4 and 5 times as many viruses as you have cells. Alternatively, for the second case, where you just want one virus per cell, okay? So the condition you can impose to get one virus per cell is something like this. Okay, so this is 0 infections, this is 1 infection, and so 1 minus this is the number of cells that have been infected more than one time. And so we want that, let's say we want that fraction to be less than 1%. So again, we apply this condition to the Poisson distribution and we solve for what lambda is. And you get something about 0.15. So you want to add 1/10 as many viruses as you have cells. Okay, so now let's see what this looks like. So let me take this and plug it in the Poisson distribution and this plug it in the Poisson and see what this looks like. Okay, so if I use a multiplicity of infection equal to 4.6 and I simulate that, this is what it looks like. And I think if you look at this thing pretty closely, you can see that there are no squares that have 0 spots. That is, every square here has been, every cell has been infected. Okay, now what about the other one? This is when we use a multiplicity of infection of 0.15. So now you can see that the number of spots we have is significantly less, but when you look at each cell only has 1 spot. Okay, so by recognizing this mutational process as a Poisson process, you can use that information to actually design the experiment to get the kind of result that you want. Okay? All right. Now, I'm not sure how everybody's doing, but I think that's actually a logical place to stop. If everybody wants to keep going, I actually have several more cool biological examples of Poisson processes. It's pretty neat. You want to see them? Okay. Okay, let's just run through this one. This one's kind of cool. So this doesn't have anything to do with mutation. It's just an example of a biological Poisson process. And so the question we're going to ask here is, our eyes operate by absorbing photons. How many photons does it take for you to actually see something? And again, we can answer this question by recognizing that the absorption of photons is a Poisson process. And so this is the reference where they first did this. You can see this was done a long time ago. All right, so again, here's our human eye. Now, the way this experiment is designed is what they do is they take people and they sit them in a very dark room, and then they fire bunches of photons directly into their eyeball. And then so they fire a bunch of photons and they ask, did you see that? And the person will say yes or no. All right, so the way it works is when they fire the photons into the eyeball, they're firing them in along a very specific trajectory into the eye. So it's only impinging a very small area on the back of the eye, which contains only about 500 cells. They're called rod cells that actually absorb the light. So there's a relatively small number of rod cells in this patch of retina. All right, so now what we're going to do is fire bunches of photons at these people. And we set up our equipment such that we know that the packets of light that we shoot at them, they contain on the order of between 20 to 400 photons. Okay, so they fire in very fast because it's light. They hit the cornea and the lens of the eye, and some of those photons get absorbed and scattered. And so by the time this packet of photons gets to the back of the eye, it's only about 10% of the original photons. The other 90% have been scattered or absorbed. So there's only about 2 to 40 photons that make it to the back. Okay, so these are the number of photons. Those are like the number of little darts that were thrown at the board. These are the number of cells. That's the number of cells in our dartboard. And so each of these is going to be spread out over this 500 cells, and so we can predict this is the average number of photons that's going to be absorbed by each rod. So it's just this number divided by this number. Okay, so this is the average number of photons per retinal cell. If you take this average and you plug it into a Poisson distribution, It looks like this. Okay, so this is simulating a Poisson distribution with this mean, where again, you should think of each of these squares as a retinal cell that's absorbing a photon, and each of the little blue spots is a photon. And what you can see is that with this mean, that the number of photons that get absorbed per cell, it's one. So I mean, if a cell, so for this, these number of photons, if you can see most of the cells do not absorb any photons. Most of the cells don't see anything. If they do absorb a photon, it is with very high probability just going to be one photon. That is, the probability of absorbing more than one photon is less than 1%. It's 0.3%. So in other words, when you fire these packets of photons at these people, and you ask them, did you see this? And they say yes. That indicates that each of these cells in the back of your eye is able to detect single photon absorption events. So your eye is actually an incredibly sensitive optical instrument. Okay, so it only requires one photon per rod cell to register in your brain as a detection event. But let's see, how much? Okay, so I'm just going to leave it at that. The story actually gets significantly more complicated. So it only takes one photon per cell to register an event, but you actually have to activate several cells in order for your brain to say, okay, I saw it. And the analysis of how many cells it takes, that's also a Poisson process. Okay, so you can, in the paper, which again, I gave it to you guys ahead of time, you can go read the paper. They again perform a Poisson analysis to extract how many rod cells is it necessary to be activated for you to see something. And it turns out that that number is between like 5 and 7. So on the order of like 6 retinal cells have to absorb one photon, and you can say, I saw that. Okay, so what we talked about today is random events. So random in both time and space, and I gave you a few examples as to how that applies to mutations and analyzing and extracting mutation rates. And so tomorrow what I'm going to do is show you an example of a mutational process that is not random, that does not obey these rules. Okay? Any questions? Oh, so the only other examples I had... So then I went through this analysis of how many retinal cells does it take. It gets kind of complicated. And then this whole example of retinoblastoma, in addition to extracting the rates, you can also predict how many tumors is the kid going to get. You can predict, you know, is the kid going to, are kids on average going to get 1, 2, or 3 or whatever tumors? And so again, you can analyze that using a Poisson analysis and show that the average number of expected tumors is 3 for the kind of mutational process we talked about. Whew. Okay, and so there's this gnarly table that's in Knudsen's paper. And so what he showed, so these are the actual measured prevalences of unilateral and bilateral retinoblastoma. And what you see is that when you plug the kinds of rates that you extract from these other analyses into a Poisson distribution, that it's most compatible, that the actual numbers that we measure are most compatible with the average number of tumors per kid being 3. But this is actually a really complicated table, and I don't think it would add much to your understanding. And we're out of time, so I'm done. Okay, any questions? All right. Cool. Yes.